Kunjabe Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Kunjabi Gopi Janna Balabha Giribhada Dhadi Gopi Jana Balabha Giribhada Dhadi Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Dandana Yasoda Nandana Jamana Jira Vana Chadi Jamana Jira Vana Chadi Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Kunjabi Hari Gopi Jana Balabha Giridhari Dhadi Gopi Jana Balabha Giridhari Dhadi Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Dandana Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Dandana Yamana Tira Bana Chadi Yamuna Tira Vana Chadi Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Jaya Vishnupad Paramahamsa Parivitika Charaja Asta Tarasita Si Srimati's Divine Grace is the Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Ananta Koti Vaishnavarinda Ki Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Gorpimanandi. What? So you say it.
Yargala Kannada Anuvada Beko, Sadanand Keshava Prabhu, Kannadadalli Anuvada Martare, Amudeli Kannada Anuvada Martare, Sadanand Keshava Prabhu Hatra Kutkoli.
How many of you have Srimad Bhagavatam, a full set of Srimad Bhagavatam in your home? Oh, very good. And of those of you that have it, please read every day. And those of you that don't yet have Srimad Bhagavatam in your home, make a plan to get Srimad, invite Krishna into your home in his literary form, because that's how Krishna makes himself, in addition to his name in this age of Kali, in the literary form he makes himself fully available in his full spiritual form as Srimad Bhagavatam. These boys that are sitting in a chair, there's an elder lady coming up the stairs and she may need their seat. Unless there's some extra chairs. Boys, could you rise and let an elder lady sit in that chair? Thank you. The teachings of Prahalad Maharaj are part of this wonderful section from Canto 7. It spans from chapter 5 through most of chapter 10. That's a big section. And it's a very much loved section of the entire Srimad Bhagavatam, and I'll give some explanation why that is so. You see here an image, a painting that was commissioned by King Prataparudra during the time of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Prataparudra was the king of Orissa as well as the king of Puri, and he commissioned one of the artist disciples of Vakreshwara Pandit to make a painting of himself with the associates of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And the king is down at the bottom here, prostrating, paying obeisances. And those of you that have been to Puri, you'll probably recognize where it is. It's Narendra Sarovar. You can tell because that's the Sarovar down here. And then this black and white checkered tile surface, that's the perimeter around Narendra Sarovar. And the scene is Gadadhar Pandit reciting Srimad Bhagavatam in the presence of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Lord Nityananda, Advaita Acharya, Srivas, Ramananda Roy, Sarup Damodar, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, and standing up over here, hanging up his clothes, that's Haridas Thakur. Although he looks a little chubby. And I don't think Haridas Thakur was chubby. He ate very little. Now the reason I'm showing this is because this is a black and white of the original that's in color. But it's just by reciting those names, it's like reciting the Panchatattva mantra. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivas Adi Gaura Bhaktavrinda. There it is. Adi Gaura Bhaktavrinda. And if you were the king and you could commission any painting at all that you wanted of Lord Chaitanya's associates, you might think it would be a kirtan scene. But it's not. It's Gadadhar Pandit reciting Srimad Bhagavatam. Because that was one of the expertises of Gadadhar Pandit. If you read very carefully, in the line of Gadadhar Pandit is Haridas Shastri. He was a disciple of a disciple of Gadadhar Pandit. He lived in Vrindavan, and he was both a pujari of the Govindaji deity, and he was a reciter of Srimad Bhagavatam. And it was from him that Ganga Mata Goswamini learned Srimad Bhagavatam and became such a wonderful reciter of Srimad Bhagavatam that when she was sent by Haridas Pandit to go to Puri to worship the deity that was no longer being properly worshipped, the deity of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, every morning after worshipping her deity, she recited Srimad Bhagavatam. And she learned from one who learned from one who learned from Gadadhar Pandit. So in addition to kirtan, this is something that we can conclude, inductively at least, this is something that devotees did regularly. They would gather together and hear Srimad Bhagavatam. And one of their favorite reciters was Gadadhar Pandit, because he was so good. In Chaitanya Bhagavat, it describes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's daily activities in Puri. He stayed at Gundicha. Early in the morning, he went for the Upalabhog, the early morning worship of Lord Jagannath. He would see the deity and he would dance in ecstasy and chant the holy name. And after some time, the pujaris would bring him prasad and articles that were offered to the deity. One of those articles eventually became Siddha Bakul. There's probably some devotees here from Puri. So one of the articles they offer every morning to Lord Jagannath is a toothbrush. Kids, did you know that? Jagannath gets a new toothbrush every morning because he has teeth. So the toothbrush is a Bakul branch that's made soft at the end, and they offer to the deity, and then it becomes tadiya, paraphernalia. So one day, when Lord Chaitanya went to see Haridas to take the prasad of Lord Jagannath, even early in the morning it was very hot. Feeling compassion, Lord Chaitanya stuck the toothbrush into the ground, and instantly a mature Bakul trees have big leaves that provide nice shade to shade Haridas. And therefore it's known as the Siddha Bakul. If you ask people in Orissa, in Puri, where is the ashram of Haridas Thakur? They don't know. Ask them, where is Siddha Bakul? They all know. So Lord Chaitanya would visit Haridas every morning, right after Lord Jagannath, bring him prasad, discuss topics about Krishna for some time, and then he would go next to Tota Gopinath. Here's the Gopinath deity. And Lord Chaitanya would have darshan of the Gopinath deity. Same as with Lord Jagannath, he would chant and dance in ecstasy for some time. And then he would sit down and hear for hours from Gadadhar Pandit from Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, a little detail about the deity. You see there's legs at the bottom, but that's only during Kartik time. The other 11 months of the year, there's no legs. because the deity is actually sitting. The deity is sitting because when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu left this world, and he was only 48, and Gadadhar Pandit was the same age, he became so feeble in feelings of separation that he couldn't place the garland over the deity's head and the crown on his head and the shingar decorations upon the deity. So the deity sat down to make it easier for him. So the other 11 months, he's seated with his legs folded. Very unique. Very unique. It is said that Lord Chaitanya disappeared entering into the body of Gopinath. There's a mark on his knee. It is said that's where he entered. Very special deity. And Chaitanya Bhagavat says, when Lord Chaitanya heard, that especially mentions the pastimes of Prahlad Maharaj and Dhruva Maharaj, he would hear them from beginning to end, and then he would say, "Say it again." If you want to play, don't sit in the front row. Don't point at him. If you want to play, don't sit in the front row. If you're going to sit in the front row, don't play. Mother and father, please do the needful, because these are playful boys that don't get the message. Okay. Lord Chaitanya said to Haridas, "Say it again. Say it again. Say it again." So I'd almost say for certain, everyone here has heard the prayers and the teachings and the pastimes of Prahlad. Our children have probably heard it many, many times. And our adults have heard it many, many times. But hearing many, many times is part of the way of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam in the association of similar-minded Vaishnavas. It's likened sometimes to making sandalwood paste. Many of you have made sandalwood paste. I have also. So it's a very simple procedure. You need three things: a flat stone, a piece of sandalwood that's maybe as big as your fist, and a little few drops of water, not too much. And, well, the Maha Mantra, or some prayers that you recite as you go in a circular motion like this, again and again and again, thinking how you're making something that's going to be offered to Krishna. So you're saying prayers or verses from scripture or whatever you like. And as you do that, very predictable what will happen. The wood becomes paste, and the paste is very fragrant. It fragrances in the wood, but do this, and the fragrance becomes stronger and stronger. And when you apply the sandalwood paste, it has a very cooling effect. Very predictable. And reciting and hearing of Srimad Bhagavatam is the same. It's like making sandalwood. Say it again and say it again, not just for repetition of the story, but the mood of love between Prahlad and the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Srila Prabhupada liked this also. He wanted to give us the same opportunity also. So as followers in his footsteps, here we are, doing what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Gadadhar Pandit did every day, and in many generations since then. Here's a photo of Prahlad at Mayapur during Chandan Yatra. They made lots of sandalwood. And they make buckets and buckets and buckets of sandalwood in Mayapur. It goes on for like 2 weeks. And there's rows of people that can all day long make sandalwood. And do they make sandalwood. They probably go through a couple of trees. So much sandalwood. There's two sentences that come at the beginning of chapter 6, the introduction section, that I want to read for you, or with you. And it summarizes the whole of the Prahlad Maharaj section in simple way. It has four parts. By accepting the lotus feet of Prahlad Maharaj, who is in the parampara succession, one will be able to understand the mode of spiritual life. In accepting this mode of activity, there is no need for material qualifications. So we'll go back to the top. By accepting the lotus feet of Prahlad Maharaj. So, my dear devotees, Prahlad Maharaj was present during Satya Yuga, and we're very far away from Satya Yuga. How are we to accept the lotus feet of Prahlad Maharaj? And the answer is through his instructions. When we take the instructions of Prahlad Maharaj, and we bring those instructions within the heart, and how do you do that? Shrinvanti, Gayanti, Grananti, Sadavaha. That's how you do. You hear again and again in the association of like-minded devotees, and you discuss the topics together with them with the eagerness that you want to be in and feel the presence of Krishna. So hear in that way, discuss in that way, and the message will enter your heart. And when the message enters your heart, this is the process of accepting the lotus feet of Prahlad Maharaj. Through his instructions, through sound vibration, we can take his association, take his shelter, and accept his lotus feet. Very important message. Second is, Prahlad is in the parampara succession. We should hear from those in the parampara succession. And Prahlad heard from Narada. And he heard from Narada for a long time. How long? The whole duration of time that Hiranyakashipu was in the forest engaging in his austerities. And there's different accounts, but the standard one is 100 celestial years. That's a long time to hear. Kayadu, the mother of Prahlad, requested a benediction from Narada. One of the benedictions she requested was that this child not be born until my husband returns from the forest having completed his austerities. So Shukadeva Goswami remained in the womb of his mother for 16 years. And when he appeared, he was a 16-year-old boy. Poor mother, she must have been very uncomfortable. But Prahlad maintained his child, infant size for 100 years. And then when Lord Nrisimhadev, when Hiranyakashipu returned from the forest. That's where chapter 4 ends, by the way. We're just going to be discussing chapter 5. That's when Prahlad was born. So he heard even before he was born. But he heard with such quality that he didn't forget. It went inside and it became his life in disciplic succession. He's one of the 12 great authorities. Mahajana Yena Katha Sapanta. One of the great authorities of all times confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam. The third is the one that I underlined. By accepting the lotus feet of Prahlad Maharaj, one will be able to understand the mode of spiritual life. Now, this is a nice audience. So I'm going to share something that I don't share unless it's a nice audience. Some of you know, you can recite with me if you know, the one verse that's of all of nectar devotion that summarizes the entire nectar devotion. Anyabhilashata shunyam yana karma janavratam anukuyena krishnanushilanam bhaktir uttama. So the message of nectar devotion is about devotion. But devotion is uttama. It's shuddha. It's perfect. It's beyond ignorance and beyond passion, beyond goodness. It's beyond the modes of nature. Bhakti is pure. Bhakti that's pure, there are some things that it doesn't have. Jnana and karma mixed in. Shuddha bhakti doesn't have mixed bhakti. There's mixed bhakti. Then there's shuddha bhakti. And Rupa Goswami is teaching us shuddha bhakti. But that's what it isn't. Jiva Goswami says those are secondary things. The primary or swarup lakshana of bhakti is found in this word anukulyena krishna anushilanam. Anukulyena krishna anushilanam. So listen carefully. I'm just going to speak about this word, the mode of activity of devotional service, the mode of spiritual life. The essence of spiritual life is bhakti, and anushilana, anu means to follow, or there's the predecessor acharyas and the perfected souls following Krishna, that's the anu, and then the shilanam. Jiva Goswami says, in order to understand what Rupa Goswami is writing, you need to examine the dhatu, or the verbal root, of anushilanam. And the verbal root is shil. And shil has two parts. A part that's always moving. When bhakti, the senses are moving, the mind is moving, the knowledge acquiring senses are moving. Then there's the non-moving part, that's this mode. That's something that doesn't change. For example, here we are in front of the deities and Prabhupada in the temple room, and some other time you may be in the kitchen, or you may be chanting your japa, or you may be going to school, or you may be in the office, you may be going to the marketplace. Those are all ways in which we can be in service to Krishna. So those things are the moving parts. And then there's the not moving part, or the mode of activity. Shil. That is, I want whatever it is that I do to be pleasing to Krishna. I want to be connected in my relationship of love to Krishna. That doesn't change. That's the unchanging part of bhakti, anushilanam. If you want to know what that mode of activity is and how to enter into it, associate with Prahlad. Take shelter of his lotus feet. Accept his lotus feet. Take the instructions. We're covering the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj. Take them into your heart. And then you'll know, not just theoretically, but experientially. You'll experience what Prahlad experiences. Maybe not so high like Prahlad, but directionally like him. The mode of pure bhakti will be yours. You'll be able to understand it, and to understand it means to live it. Very important, very powerful. And then finally, the fourth part is, in accepting this mode of activity, there's no need for material qualifications. The Hare Krishna movement rests upon that fact. It's abundantly explained by our acharyas. I've been listening to Prabhupada explaining in the Nectar Devotion series in Vrindavan this fact over and over. But persons are being engaged in bhakti, persons are being engaged in chanting of the holy name and various forms of devotional service, including worship of the deity who by birth, by the Vaidika Vidhis, aren't eligible. But they become eligible by the Panchanatrika system, by this system of hearing the name, form, quality, pastimes of the personality of Godhead and his pure devotees, like Prahlad Maharaj. One becomes qualified. So there's no material disqualifier. Again and again and again, Prahlad refers to himself as disqualified because of his birth, born in a demoniac family. Doesn't have a good education. He's only a little boy. He's only 5 years old. What education does he have? And the demigods, they've offered wonderful, wonderful prayers with high language. And he is this little boy that doesn't even have education. What's his qualification to speak? His qualification is not, is his devotion. And the material disqualifications are not disqualifiers. It's a major teaching in Prahlad's teachings, the teaching of the Bhagavatam, and it's a primary message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and our society. So with that, we'll begin just a little section of chapter 5, and chapter 5 comes after chapter 4. And chapter 4... the Bhagavatam describes the desire, the terrorist, global, universal terrorist, Hiranyakashipu, who traveled all over the universe, intimidating everybody, conquering everybody, wanted to become, he took over the post of the King of Heaven. And he was thinking, I'm almost there. I just need to be eternal, then I'll be God. Because I'm ruling heaven and earth, the whole universe, and if I'm eternal, I'm God. So he wanted to become eternal. So he went to the forest, did his austerities, very, 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 very severe. Very severe, without detailing. The whole universe was intimidated by him. Brahma came, restored his body to a beautiful, youthful body. Hiranyakashipu wanted immortality. Brahma said, I can't give you immortality. And even I'm not immortal. So ask for something I can give you. And in a very clever way, we know the story. I can't be killed this way, that way, the other way, and now I'm immortal. And then he returned, took over the kingdom of heaven again. Because in his absence, the demigods came back, but they had to leave again. Powerful Hiranyakashipu was back. Kayadu returned, Prahlad was born. Prahlad was placed in the school, the Asurakula. We have, in ISKCON, we have Gurukulas. But this was an Asurakula, taught by the chief Asura Brahmanas, the sons of Shukracharya, who is the priest of the Daityas, Shanda and Amarka by name. So Hiranyakashipu placed his son, and some of the others in his kingdom placed their sons in their school to teach them how to become good asuras. And Hiranyakashipu had fatherly affection, with some limits, of course. But so one day, Hiranyakashipu placed his son on his lap and very affectionately inquired, "My dear son, please let me know what you think is the best of all subjects you have studied from your teachers." Now he was thinking Shanda and Amarka are his teachers. But Prahlad wasn't thinking Shanda and Amarka, they're not teachers. There's one teacher that I have had, and that's Narada Muni. So he doesn't mention his name because he's speaking to his father. But he speaks the following verse that let us recite together aloud, and then we'll spend some time with this verse. Tatsadu manye suravarya dehinam sadasamud vigna diam asatrahat hidvatma patam griham andakupam vanam gatoyad dharim ashayeta. So I'm going to spend some time with the language of the verse, but I'll just share something with you first. I have taken again and again and again, many times, I've gone over the prayers of Prahlad and the teachings of Prahlad because they're so fundamental, and because Lord Chaitanya did it. And you can't go wrong. You follow in the footsteps of Lord Chaitanya. And something happened by doing that. There's a transformation. Some lights went on, and I could understand things that I couldn't understand before by the mercy of Prahlad. The teachings are quite simple, and they're very powerful and profound. So my, not from our acharyas, but kind of my sense of these teachings of Prahlad, they're layer upon layer upon layer of expanding the teachings of pure bhakti. In chapter 10, when the final set of prayers by Prahlad are being offered to Lord Nrisingadev, one of those verses, chapter 10, verse number 6, he says, "You sent me here to this world, a place that's filled with ignorance and passion, and people are unnecessarily suffering as a result. So you sent me to teach the way of devotional service." So he does. He teaches by words, prachar, and by his character, achar. And hang out with Prahlad. Sadhu Sangha. Hear from him again and again. And qualities that are Prahlad's become something that warms your heart. And it becomes qualities like your qualities, the mode of pure devotional service becomes yours. So this verse is kind of like a foundational verse. There's elements in it that the other teachings are simply expanding or elucidating further. It's a very important verse. It's the first verse of his teachings. It's spoken to his father. His father wants to know, what's the best thing that you've learned? And his response is, we'll start with this word at the end of the first line, is Dehinam. Now, I'm not a Sanskrit scholar, but I've heard Prabhupada enough times to know there are these two words, Dehi and Deha. Deha is the body, and Dehi is one who's in a body, and that's us, we're in a body. And Dehi Nam is the plural. So, we all have bodies. There probably aren't any ghostly beings floating around here somewhere, the unembodied ones. We all have bodies, and the body, having a body isn't a problem. It's what you do with it, or how you regard it, that can be a problem, or can be liberating or binding. So then comes this other word, asat grahat. You'll see in the translation, Prabhupada takes this to the place of attachment to family life. Now, there's sat, chapter 2, Bhagavad Gita. There's sat and there's asat. Nasate vijite bhavo no bhavo vijite sataha. There's sat and there's asat. And the tattvadarshis, the seers of the truth, they don't place so much value in asat. They may deal with it. Many of you, most of you, are grahastas. And you're very involved in things that are temporary. Being involved in things that are temporary is not itself problematic. It's being overly attached to the temporary that's problematic. Overly attachment is the byproduct of trying to be the enjoyer artificially of something we're not meant to be the enjoyer of. So I'm visiting in a family's home. Supposing I like something in their home, I just put it in my pocket and walk away because I like it. We enter this world, that's a thief. We enter this world owning nothing, and we leave the world owning nothing. And in between, we're so busy trying to make things ours. That's the divine and demoniac chapter of Bhagavad Gita. It's the demoniac nature. So to think something is mine, that's mama. There's aham, and the other is mama, ahama meti. Chapter 2, Canto 2 of Srimad Bhagavatam elaborately discusses the I and mine features of material consciousness. So asat grahat, this phrase here, is dealing with attachment to the temporary, the mind. I am the body, deha, I'm dehi, but I think I'm deha. And then if I'm dehi, excuse me, I'm the body, then what's mine is what's produced from the body. Like my work comes from my body, and so the fruits of my work is mine. And so the fruits of the work means my bank account and my home, my car, my cell phone, my stuff. That's mine. Resting upon the false conception of self. So that's the Dehi Nam and Asat Grahat. And those that have that attachment or too much affinity for asat. In the language of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, it's asat trishna. Trishna means thirst. We should have Krishna Trishna, not asat trishna. And when there's too much thirst for the temporary, then samudvigna dhyam. Samudvigna means disturbed, agitated, mad. And D, whenever you see that syllable, D-H-I, like bodhi, D, it means intelligence. When one's intelligence becomes disturbed. When the intelligence is disturbed, supposing you're a parent. Some of you are parents. You don't have to suppose anything. Supposing you're a parent and you're overly attached to your child and something happens. It can be any something. You know, some bad behavior, or they fall into bad association, or something. They get hurt, something. Something happens. Now, if you're overly attached, you don't know what to do. And if you're appropriately attached, you know what to do. Life becomes very complex. I was in Singapore yesterday, and for a few days. And there was a nice question in one of the university classes where someone stood up and said, you're speaking about meditation, mantra meditation, the benefits of it, but how to do that in this age of complexity? And she went on and basically described the life of a millennial. She didn't use the word, but I'm very familiar now. You all know what's involved in modern life of a college student. Very, 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 very complex. So, how to do that in our present age, in present circumstance? The soul is still the soul. The circumstance can be whatever the circumstance is, and it's always changing. But if the foundational, if the mode of activity is like that of Prahlad, if the mode of activity is shield, founded in that which doesn't change even when things are changing, you can remain fixed, just like Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. One who experiences this consciousness of happiness within, anything can be happening out there in the world of duality, and you're just fine, because that happiness is within. It's not created or destroyed by the circumstances around you. Vasudevi Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojataha Janiyate Yashu Vairagyam Jnanam Cha Yadahaitukam. When you engage in devotional service properly, knowledge and detachment follow. Like a queen has ladies in waiting or attendants, and wherever she goes in the palace, her attendants are following behind her. So if you're engaged similarly, if you're engaged in bhakti, nicely performed, knowledge and detachment follows. But if it's simply a matter of attachment to the temporary, your power of discrimination becomes weakened, and your attachment takes over, and you don't really know what's best. Although you care a lot because you're attached, you don't know what's best. And in fact, you don't know what's best. Yenatma suprasediti ahaitukiya pratiyata yayatma suprasediti. That devotional service which brings that complete satisfaction within doesn't know a material cause and doesn't know a material obstacle that can stop it. because it's spiritual. Prahlad is teaching that mode. So those that are in this asat grahat position, their intelligence is very agitated, very disturbed. Then the second half is he recommends such a person is compared to someone who has fallen into a well, andakupam, blind well. Now in America, people don't use wells so much. They have the central water system. But in India, certainly in rural parts of India, it's very common. And I know somebody that died falling into a blind well. Really nice person. They were out doing some service for someone else at night, and they were walking, and they couldn't see because grass had grown over the mouth of the well. And they fell down the bottom of the well, and no one even heard them scream as they were falling. And then in the morning, they found a body at the bottom of the well. His neck broke, and the autopsy showed. Very sad. That was my introduction to blind wells. A very, very heavy experience, I'll tell you. Very wonderful person. But this andakupam, Prahlad is saying, it's like someone who's fallen into a dark well where there's no water and only misery. The asat grahat person. And finally, vanam gato, they should go to the forest. And hari ashrayeta, take shelter of the personality of Godhead Hari. Just what Hiranyakashipu wanted to hear, right? Because from chapter 3, it was the funeral of his younger brother Hiranyaksha, and at the end of the funeral he took a vow. This Lord Vishnu who killed my brother, he's my enemy. And I will take revenge. I will destroy Vishnu. Now here's his son saying, take shelter of Hari. He didn't want to hear that. Here's Prabhupada's translation. Oh, best of the Asuras, king of the demons, as far as I have learned from my spiritual master, he didn't say Narada's name, any person who has accepted a temporary body, Dehinam, and temporary household life, Asatgrahat, is certainly embarrassed by anxiety, that's the Sumudvigna. Embarrassed by anxiety because of having fallen in a dark well where there is no water but only suffering. One should give up this position and go to the forest, vana. More clearly, one should go to Vrindavan where only Krishna consciousness is prevalent and should thus take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now that's the best thing that he's learned. Now some of you, you're a good audience, so I'm going to share something else with you. There's a really nice section of Canto 1. One of my favorite chapters in Canto 1 is Chapter 13. And that's where Vidura delivers his elder brother Dhritarashtra. Now from Mahabharata, we know that Dhritarashtra was the elder brother, then Pandu, then Vidura. So Vidura was younger, but Vidura was born as the maid servant of Ambika, so he was considered, because of his mother's position, as Shudra. So he was honored by the royal family, as part of the royal family, but he didn't have the Kshatriya position. But he was also known as very wise. regularly Dhritarashtra would turn to Vidura for counsel. Unfortunately, when it came to his sons, especially Duryodhana, he was unable to follow what he said. There's details and details and details of advice that Vidura would give. When it finally came to Vidura being insulted by Duryodhana in the royal assembly, he considered, I've tried, and there really isn't any service for me here. So he left. He didn't leave because he was insulted. I'm getting out of here. These people are nasty. He left because there was no service for him. So he went on pilgrimage. He met Maitreya and came back. And when he came back for one reason. Not to have a good meal or a comfortable bed. He came to deliver his elder brother. And he did. And when he did, he got him in a solitary place where no one else could hear, except he and Gandhari. And he let him have it. Really strong language. You're living like a dog in the house of your master, Bhima, who killed Duryodhana, and now you're eating scraps off his plate. Have you no shame? Your teeth are falling out. Your liver isn't working. You're about to die. Don't you hear the knock on the door? Death is approaching. Give this up. This vanam gato. Prabhupada explains, detachment from this world can be of different levels, and what was being requested of Dhritarashtra, same as Hiranyakashipu, was a lower level. Because actually Dhritarashtra was an elevated, exalted personality. He was blind by birth, but he was also blind by attachment. He couldn't hear what Vidura said. He couldn't hear what Akura said. Akura gave the same advice. He couldn't follow it. He said, Akura, what you're saying is true, but I can't follow it. Like Dhruva said to Narada, your advice, Narada, is right, but I'm a Kshatriya. I want a kingdom. Tell me how I can get a kingdom. Tell me how I can get Vishnu, and he can give me the kingdom. That's what Mom said. So the topmost position in this verse is not what's being recommended for Hiranyakashipu, nor for Dhritarashtra, because they just weren't capable. The Narottama, the topmost condition of Nara, is Mahabhagavata. That's what Prahlad is. That's what Narada is. That's what Vidura had become. And that can be recommended for somebody who has the capacity. But minimally, for those in this asat-grahat position, it's a good thing to do, to leave attachment. You don't have to go to the forest literally, but leave attachment to the temporary, to the side, and become attached to sat. Bhagavad Gita. Nasate vijate bhavo, nabhavo vijate sataha. Ubayor apadrishton tas twanios tatvadarsha bihi. Very basic teaching. Not just detachment from asat, but attachment to sat. And specifically, Hari, the personality of Godhead. Right away, he's introducing his father to bhakti. His father. Now, his father didn't want to hear it. But Prahlad was giving it anyway, to take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in such a wonderful place as Vrindavan. your deities here are Gandharvika, Giridhari. And as you probably know, that's the name that Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave to his principal deities, where his headquarters are in Mayapur. There's a wonderful story behind those deities. You probably know the story, so I won't get lost in that story. Take shelter of the lotus feet of Prahlad Maharaj by hearing the instructions, the teachings, the mode or the mood of spiritual life. He's a Vaikunthavasi and he wants to take us there. Hear from him. That's our opportunity. The opportunity is being very generously given to us through Srimad Bhagavatam by our founder Acharya, Srila Prabhupada. So I'm going to end there and see if there's any discussion. Do you have something? Yes? How do we understand what? Yeah. How do we today go to the forest? That's what you're asking? That's what you're asking? Well, I kind of hinted at it in terms of saying it's not that literally vanaprastha stage of life described in the same seventh canto of the Bhagavatam is a Satya Yuga principle. Or the application of the principle, excuse me. It literally means going to the forest. Something like what Ramachandra did in Dwarpa Yuga. He took tree bark and bare feet and everything. Lived on roots and fruits and whatever is there in the forest. In our present age, that's not so practical. So what it means is detaching oneself from the comforts, the amenities, the sense of being the enjoyer of the temporary. So here we are in Bangalore. Doesn't mean you have to change your dress and go to the jungle. That's not the meaning. So what does it mean? That's your question. That's your question? For us in practical terms. Take those same temporary things, your car, your computer, your cell phone, your stuff. Simplify. Don't accumulate more than required. Simplify what you require in service to Krishna and see those things as instruments meant for service to Krishna, suitable for serving Krishna, and then not otherwise. Now the difficulty is the otherwise part. Anasakti, it's taught in Rupa Goswami's Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Anasaktasya Vishayan. You familiar with the verse? Yatarham upayunjitaha. Nirbanda Krishna Sambande Yuktam Vairagya Uchate. Anasaktasya Vishayan. Vishaya means sense enjoyment. Anasaktashi, which means without attachment to sense enjoyment. So there's the objects. You're in your home. You're not going to the forest. You're in your home. You're going back to your home tonight. You're in your home. You're looking around your house. And you see stuff. Without attachment to those objects, according to suitability, yatarham, it's a tricky word, according to suitability, upayunjitaha, you engage that in Krishna service. Without attachment to a sense enjoyment, according to suitability, you engage something in Krishna service. One of your children may be musically inclined, so you provide musical training and musical instruments so they can engage that propensity in service to Krishna. Another child has visual aptitude, so you get coloring books and you show them. There's one of our youth in America. You know how kids do during class. They'll sometimes sit and draw. So this young boy from childhood, he would draw. And now he is like a really talented artist, and he likes digital art. And he's going into filmmaking. He has a scholarship at New York University in their film school, just from sitting in the Bhagavatam class making drawings. And the parents gave facilities for that. So as a parent, as a person, according to suitability, you engage things in Krishna service without attachment to sense enjoyment, but with the mode of spiritual activity. That's what you do. And cultivate inwardly attachment to Krishna, to the medium of trying to please him, yourself and your family members and your friends of the family, the circle that goes out, the community. And then you're no longer in Bangalore. You're in Vaikuntha. Prabhupada said that. I heard him say it 3 times. And he was speaking about New York, not Bangalore. He said, this temple is not in Brooklyn. It's in Vaikuntha. And his eyes got big. Because it wasn't with attachment to Vishaya. We had a big building in New York. And we weren't attached to the big building, we were attached to service to Radha Govinda. Vaikuntha. Vanam. Gato. Leave the mood of attachment to be the enjoyer of the temporary and place that at the feet of Krishna. Let him be the enjoyer. It's all his. Yeah. Yes. Do we have a portable microphone? Go ahead, keep going. There are elements of bhakti that are moving and those that are not, yes. Yeah. Yeah, it's too easy. By understanding the instruction to do so. It's exactly what's in why I showed that, but those 2 sentences. The mode of activity, there's the activity, that's the moving part. Then there's the mode of the activity, that's the non-moving part. We can understand it by taking shelter of the lotus feet of Prahalad Maharaj. By hearing him and letting the teaching go inside. And just keep doing it, practice. Shrinvanti, Gayanti, Grananti. It happens. My experience is, I love Srimad Bhagavatam because I have found that it has changed how I experience the world around me. The world around me is still very strange. But how I experience it has changed. Just from Srimad Bhagavatam. For real. And someone doesn't have to tell me. I can experience it. And I would like for others to have that same transformation. That's why I do the moving part. Constantly. That the how-to is just, we want it. We want shanti. But we want it to be run in the wrong way without understanding what it really is and how to get there. The Srimad Bhagavatam wants us to give us what it really is and really experience it. Something else? Yes? We have to hear repeatedly. How many times? Constantly, regularly, how to hear? That's your question. Every day. You know, Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya is the language of the Bhagavatam. Nityam means eternally, like non-stop. But, you know, you have a son in your lap. You probably have to do things to help him. And you have to probably have to earn a living to maintain. So, Nityam means then minimally, daily. Every day. And some find a way so that every day you can hear. There are ways in your home or cyber or come to the temple or whatever it is. With technology, there's a zillion ways. It's just a question of desire to do so. In the association of devotees. There's a very popular thing that's happening these days is reading groups. I won't go into details. Keshava Bharati Maharaj told me he has a reading group of something like 3,000 people every day. 3,000 people every day. 3,000 people every day, and that's one person. Because he likes to read, and people like to read with somebody who likes to read. So there's smaller groups of people that do this all the time. Sometimes it's at night. Sometimes it's in the morning. Sometimes it's during lunch break. So you find a way that it works. Where there's a will, there's a way. And you can just do it in your room, in your temple room. The peacefulness and solitude of a sanctified place in your home. I know people that do that every day. Every day. Nityam. Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati. I like the word bhavati. It's voila. Bhakti bhavati. Naishtuki. Okay. So we're going to end, I think. There's one last thing I want to do. And a little entertainment. You say some things and I'm going to get this ready.
Hare Krishna. So we have all been blessed by the fortune of having the association of Maharaj and hearing from him. And as Varada Krishna Prabhu told, Maharaj comes quite often. Every year he's been coming here, and that's a great benefit for all of us. Maharaj has also been conducting yatras for almost the past 2 decades. And many of